Hi everyone. In the previous video, I said many people think that mathematics is the most objective intellectual activity. But as a matter of fact, since mathematics has been heavily influenced by people's beliefs and imagination, it can never be objective. Moreover, since a strong and very sophisticated religious belief underlies it, I said mathematics is a religion, and especially our modern mathematics is a full-blown version of that religion of mathematics. To figure out what kind of religious belief underlies our modern mathematics, we started to look at a specific number type, which is real numbers. You should note that while rational numbers, which include natural numbers, positive fractions, zero, negative integers, and negative fractions, are used practically in your everyday life, irrational numbers, which constitute almost all part of the real numbers, are never used practically in your everyday life, but are only used in the realm of mathematics and science. Then, why and for what purpose were these irrational numbers introduced into the realm of mathematics? Also, why are irrational numbers called real numbers? Actually, answering these questions is a key to understanding what kind of religious belief underlies our modern mathematics. In order to figure this out, we'll have to revisit the Pythagoreans in ancient Greece because they gave rise to the idea of irrational numbers. So, let's begin. First, let's go over again what the Pythagoreans believed and argued. As I said in the previous video, the Pythagoreans believed that numbers were the elements of all beings, and the universe as a whole was composed of harmony and numbers. More mathematically speaking, they believed that all phenomena in the universe can be reduced to whole numbers and their ratios. For example, they believed that the harmony of music and the motion of heavenly bodies are reduced to whole numbers and their ratios. This very belief they held towards geometry and geometric figures. More specifically, they believed that the ratios of the length of any pair of line segments can always be reduced to a ratio of whole numbers. In modern mathematical terms, if the length of a certain line segment is said to be the unit length, which is 1, then the length of another line segment can be expressed as a rational number. For example, the length of the first line segment is 2 over 3, the length of the third line segment is 16 over 11, the length of the fourth line segment is 12 over 5, and so on. However, the important thing is that they found a pair of line segments whose ratio cannot be expressed as a ratio of whole numbers. These kinds of lines are called incommensurable lines in the sense that they have no common measure. And a pair of incommensurable lines were found through their well-known theorem, the Pythagorean theorem. I'll explain this in a little more detail using our modern mathematical terms. As you know, the Pythagorean theorem is about a relation among the three sides of a right triangle. According to the theorem, the square of the length of the hypotenuse equals the sum of the square of the length of the two legs. With this triangle, c squared equals a squared plus b squared. Then, the problem arises when you think of a right isosceles triangle with a side length of 1. If you let the length of the hypotenuse of this triangle be x, then, according to the Pythagorean theorem, x squared equals 1 squared plus 1 squared. Therefore, x squared equals 2. However, a Pythagorean named Hippasus proved that there is no rational number whose square is 2. That means there is no rational number that can represent the length of the hypotenuse of this triangle. So, the hypotenuse of this triangle and its side are incommensurable lines. Since this contradicted the Pythagorean belief that all phenomena in the universe can be reduced to whole numbers and their ratios, it caused the Pythagoreans a sheer agony. Legend has it that Hippasus was killed by his fellow Pythagoreans for this discovery. Then, how was this issue dealt with and how did it pan out afterward? As you might guess, the Pythagoreans couldn't resolve this issue because of their strong belief in whole numbers. Rather, it was resolved by another group with a different belief. They were the Platonists, and they had a strong religious belief in geometry, that geometry is a body of truth. It's a well-known fact that over the doors of Plato's academy, there were words saying, "Let no one ignorant of geometry enter." Actually, Plato called for knowledge of incommensurable lines. And finally, a person who was a pupil of Plato for a time came up with a resolution to this issue. His name was Eudoxus, and what he did was, put it simply, to invent a new theory and to use it to justify incommensurable lines and their ratios. Actually, to them that believe that geometry is true, it would have been unquestionable that incommensurable lines exist. Therefore, he invented a new theory, which is now called Eudoxus' theory of proportion, that can justify incommensurable lines and their ratios. So, it is through this theory of proportion that many irrational numbers were introduced as the ratios of incommensurable lines and became legitimate entities in mathematics. For example, the square root of 2 is the ratio of the hypotenuse of an isosceles triangle to its side. Pi, one of the famous irrational numbers in mathematics, is the ratio of the circumference of a circle to its diameter. And the golden ratio, 1 plus the square root of 5 over 2, is the ratio of the diagonal of a regular pentagon to its side. But you should note that at the time of Eudoxus, all these irrational numbers were neither considered numbers nor expressed numerically. Rather, they were just understood geometrically. So, basically, the Pythagorean belief that all phenomena in the universe can be reduced to whole numbers and their ratios was taken down and was replaced by the strong religious belief in geometry. Since then, geometry had been the ultimate authority for all rigorous mathematics for the next 2,000 years. This left many legacies in history, and one of them is that we still speak of x times x as x squared instead of saying x to the second, and also speak of x times x times x as x cubed instead of saying x to the third. As time went by, however, people like Archimedes tried to estimate the numerical values of irrational numbers. For example, he estimated pi to be greater than 3 and 1 over 7 and less than 3 and 10 over 71. Also, the mathematicians used irrational numbers freely in calculations as they did with whole numbers and fractions. Later, the irrational numbers which were not directly triggered by geometry were even conceived, such as the roots of algebraic equations of a degree more than 3, logarithms, and so on. But the important thing is that all irrational numbers, including the ones that were not directly triggered by geometry, were only able to be justified by geometry. For example, let's think of a long straight line. The mathematicians thought that each rational number and irrational number can be represented by the length of a line segment on this line. More specifically, if you set the length of a line segment to be the unit length, which is 1 actually, then the square root of 2 is represented by the length of this line segment, pi is represented by the length of this line segment, and the golden ratio is represented by the length of this line segment. Also, the irrational numbers which were not directly triggered by geometry were thought to be represented by the length of some line segments on this straight line. This idea developed into the number line, where if the number 0 is assigned to one of the points on the line, which is called the origin, then Rational and irrational numbers together have a one-to-one correspondence with the points on this line according to their distance from the origin. At first, this correspondence was only assumed between positive numbers and the points on the line, but later this correspondence extended to negative numbers and the points on the other side of the origin, too. This kind of geometrical thinking gradually led many prominent mathematicians to blur the distinction between rational numbers and irrational numbers, and they start to think that the status of irrational numbers is equivalent to that of rational numbers. So, the irrational numbers, which were not considered numbers when they were originally introduced into mathematics, became considered numbers in the end. For example, let's look at what 16th and 17th century Dutch mathematician Stevin said. Any radical is a number. There are no numbers which are absurd, irrational, irregular, inexplicable, or absurd. From this remark, we know that irrational numbers had been called absurd, irregular, inexplicable, etc. Also, he argued that quantities such as square roots, irrational numbers, surds, negative numbers, etc. should all be treated as numbers and not distinguished as being different in nature. Not only that, but Isaac Newton said in his book titled Universal Arithmetic, by number, we understand the abstracted ratio of any quantity to another quantity of the same kind, which we take for unity. And this is threefold: integer, fracted, and third. An integer is what is measured by unity, a fraction that which a submultiple part of unity measures, and a third to which unity is incommensurable. Here, the word third means irrational number. And you can see that he considered irrational numbers as numbers. Of course, there was opposition to irrational numbers being considered numbers. Rather, there had always been controversies over them. One of the main reasons was that irrational numbers involve infinity when they are expressed numerically. For example, to approach the accurate value of the square root of 2, you could provide a sequence of rational numbers that are getting closer and closer to the square root of 2, such as 1.4, 1.41, 1.414, 1.4142, and so on and forth. However, since this sequence goes on indefinitely, the values of irrational numbers were considered vague and unclear. Let's look at the remark of one of the famous medieval mathematicians, Stifel. He said, on the other hand, other considerations compel us to deny that irrational numbers are numbers at all. Therefore, just as an infinite number is not a number, so an irrational number is not a true number, but lies hidden in a kind of a cloud of infinity. However, despite all the controversies and doubts over them, irrational numbers were accepted as numbers in the end. As you have seen, the introduction of irrational numbers into mathematics and the change in their status afterwards would not have been possible without geometrical justifications. So, we are led to the following question. What on earth is the essence of geometry which made all this possible? Answering this question will help us understand what irrational numbers really are. So in the next video, we'll go deeper and find out the answers to the questions. Please look forward to it, and I hope to see you in the next video. Thank you for watching today's video.